spiritual fellowship. Amen. It's good to get together, hang out, have fun, laugh, joke, things of that nature. But true fellowship is centered around God and His Word. Amen. True spiritual fellowship. And times like this just simply cannot be replaced anyway. So I'm thankful that God has brought us together again this morning. And I feel impressed this morning to elaborate, I guess, a little bit more. I've made a couple of references both this past Wednesday night and I believe last Sunday morning, maybe, about something that I feel like God has been dealing with me about for the past couple of weeks. And I want to share some of that with you this morning. I want to start in Judges chapter 16 and verse number 16. And without going into a lot of context, as many of you I'm sure would be familiar with already, this is the story of Samson. Judges chapter 16, more specifically the story of Samson and Delilah. But there's a verse here, a phrase actually, what I want to get at, which is what I feel like we desperately need to understand and need to work to combat. And Christ has given us a way to combat this. But it came about when she pressed him, when she, Delilah, pressed him, Samson, daily with her words, and she urged him, trying to find out what the source of his strength was. She pressed him daily with her words and urged him that his soul was annoyed to death. Anybody ever spoke that phrase, "You're worrying me to death"? That's where we get this from. It's Delilah was worrying Samson to death. She pressed him daily with her words so that his soul was annoyed. That's New American Standard Bible says annoyed. King James says vexed. We don't use the term vexed a lot. You might hear some older people use the word vexed from time to time. Maybe, I don't know, maybe, I don't know, there may not be anybody that old. Vexed is 16th century English. Annoyed is current modern English. But the words refer to the same thing. She vexed him. She annoyed his soul to the place where he was worn out, death. I looked up, and I'm going to show you some other scriptures that back this up, but the Hebrew word for annoyed here or vexed in the King James is quasar. And it means to make ineffective or powerless. Think about that. She pressed him daily with her words and urged him to give up his secret, the source of his holiness, the source of his righteousness, the source of his power, in Samson's case, physical strength. She pressed him daily to find out what the source of his power was. She pressed him so much that his soul was annoyed, made powerless. His soul was made powerless. His soul was limited to death. She wore him down to the place where it's either I'm going to give in to her or I'm going to die. We use the term loosely, you know, you're worrying me to death. But I'm not anywhere close to physically dying. The Bible doesn't exaggerate. When it says he was vexed unto death, that's a very serious and real statement. It's not a cliche like we throw around. Samson was not trusting her is why he lied to her twice before. And yet, being in a relationship with someone that he didn't trust with the source of his power eventually wore him down to a very deep and dark place. The Bible says close to death. Interesting, right? How many of you have felt like just through the pressures of life that many times our soul literally gets worn down to where it is powerless? It's weak. It becomes limited. We get so emotionally distraught, so emotionally tired by the struggles, the temptations, the trials that we face. And when you get emotionally worn down and emotionally weary, your soul literally gets to the place where it is powerless to make the right decisions. It is so limited because it's been vexed so much that your soul, which is, by the way, for those of you who may not be familiar, the mind, the will, and the emotions. That's what the human soul is comprised of. So we are so overwhelmed with circumstances and tests and trials that our mind doesn't have the capability of making the right decision. Anybody ever been that? Lift your hand. Is this? I'm not exaggerating with this. I would think any of us who are old enough to have lived for ourselves would have experienced that at least to some degree, to where we feel so pressured by what we're going through that we know what the right thing to do is, but we don't have the power within us to make that decision. We are literally overcome, and our soul has been made powerless because it's been vexed for so hard and so long. Make sense? Let me make it practical. Let's say you're on a diet and you're trying to lose weight, but you're sitting around all your friends, and all your friends are just eating pizza and cheeseburgers and everything else. And you go through this for days, weeks, and you stand strong. But eventually you get to the point where you're like, you are so vexed that even though in your heart you know what the right decision is, you are overcome and your soul has become so powerless from being vexed that you don't even have the ability to make what you know is the right choice. That is the ploy of the enemy against the followers of Christ. To get us so surrounded by circumstances and people who are walking according to their flesh that our soul becomes so vexed and weary from the trials and the temptations that we get to a place where he has literally made our souls powerless. And we don't have the ability to make the right choice anymore because we are so constantly inundated with vexation. I'll show you a couple of more verses. Very quickly, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this because I've got a number of verses and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on some of them. But I do want to give them to you so you can take them home, write them down, and meditate on these scriptures later. 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 8 makes an interesting statement concerning Lot, which is much the same situation, in fact, the exact same situation that Samson found himself in. Now notice, both Lot and Samson made carnal decisions that put them in the position to be vexed. Samson should have never had anything to do with Delilah. He should have never been associated with her. He should have never been in a relationship with her. But because he couldn't control his flesh, he enjoyed the relationship with her, and eventually that relationship wore him down and vexed his soul even unto death. Same thing happened to Lot. Abraham and Lot stood on the mountain, and Abraham told Lot, you choose which place you're going to dwell, and I'll choose the place I'm going to dwell. And Lot chose what? The well-watered plains of Sodom and Gomorrah. And so he ended up living in a city and dealing with people on a daily basis who were so given to carnality and the carnal mind that they were vexing Lot. That's what Peter describes here. 2 Peter 2 and 8, for by what he saw and heard, that righteous man, and if you read the context of this, it's talking about Lot, while living among them, homosexuals, felt his righteous soul tormented. Same thing's happening, it just uses a different word to describe it. NASB used annoyed to death in the Old Testament, but it uses tormented day and night by their lawless deeds. He was surrounded by people who were living in wickedness and unrighteousness and unholiness. And it bothered him. Should righteousness or should unrighteousness bother a righteous person? Yes, absolutely. But here's the problem. Lot should have never been surrounded or so intimately involved. As long as we're on this earth, we're going to be at least to some degree interacting with unrighteousness and unholiness. But the mistake that Samson and Lot made and so many others was that instead of separating themselves as much as they could from unrighteousness, they went and dwelt right in the middle of it. They got as close to they could. They straddled the fence between righteousness and unrighteousness and got on the extreme end of unrighteousness while trying to maintain their own righteousness. And that battle that was within them caused them to be vexed. Why does the scripture say flee the very appearance of evil? If it looks like it might be evil, you run the other way. Don't go move in the middle of it. Run the other way. That's why the scriptures tell us this, because God in His wisdom knows how the human soul works. And we think, well, I'm righteous enough, it's not going to affect me. You are lying to yourself in a more deceptive way than most people who are trying to trick you are lying to you. You're lying to yourself in a greater way. Well, I can be around it. I can change it. I can influence it. I can turn it around. I can turn them around. What will happen is you go in trying to keep your own righteousness. But the longer you are associated closely with unrighteousness, as I said, we've all got to deal with unrighteousness to some degree. But to associate myself so closely with it, it will eventually wear my soul down to where I can't make the decisions that I know is the right thing to do. I don't have the strength to follow through. My soul has been limited. My ability for my mind to choose what is right has been so weakened through constant vexation that I no longer have the ability or the strength, more specifically, have the strength to make the right decision. Make sense? So I give you two examples, but examples are all throughout the scriptures concerning this. This whole point. David writes so much about this same principle in the Psalms, being closely related, closely associated with the wicked. How many times does David write about the Psalm about his soul was downcast within him because he saw the wicked prosper? Vexed, annoyed, tormented, because he's too closely associated with things he shouldn't even be associated with at all. And it wears you down. Is this crazy talk? Or have y'all lived this too? Because some of y'all are looking at me like, you've lived this, right? You know this to be true because to some degree, we've experienced it in the past. That's why the Bible screams at us for separation. For that very reason. The more we try to associate with and relate to unholiness, the more our soul will get vexed. We're not pulling them up. They're pulling us down. You don't win unrighteous people by accepting their unrighteousness. You win unrighteous people by preaching against unrighteousness. If I say I'm going to win the unrighteous, but then I move in and I start accepting things and I start relating to them and I start thinking like they think, who has won who? Instead of winning them to how God thinks, they've won me to how they think. And all the while, I've deceived myself saying I'm doing the work of God, but all the while, I'm being dragged further and further away from God. I could talk all day long about how that exact dynamic has played out. The amount of adultery and fornication that's in churches today. Divorce and remarriage is rampant. When the scriptures are plain, Jesus was very plain. If you marry after you've been divorced, you commit adultery. As plain as day. It couldn't have been said in a plainer way. But now most churches excuse it and justify it, and the preacher's been married two or three different times. How did that happen? How did we get to that point? Those in charge of that particular church got so close to people who were living in adultery because of divorce and remarriage that they so loved those people that they began to think like those people. Same dynamic is at play. The soul gets vexed to the degree over the course of time, it wears us down to the degree that instead of we teaching them to think like God, they teach us to think like them. In so many, not just divorce and remarriage, in so many topics, it happens corporately in churches. I see it happen to people individually all the time. They surround themselves with people who don't think according to the scriptures. And we justify it by saying, I'm going to win them. But we don't win them. They win us. Again, you don't win unrighteousness by associating with unrighteousness. You win unrighteousness by preaching against unrighteousness. Well, you're not going to be very effective. But whoever wants righteousness will come out. And whoever doesn't want unrighteousness will stay in. That's the way Jesus ministered. That's the way the apostles ministered. They laid it out there for every man to choose. Vexation of our soul, to limit our soul to the ability that it dies in a form of speaking. It dies to the place where it doesn't have the strength or the ability to make the right choice any longer. Even though it knows what the right choice is, it lacks the strength to follow through on choice of righteousness. None of us are above this. There's not one person in here that's spiritual enough that you can constantly subject yourself to unrighteousness and not be won to unrighteousness. Not one of us. The flesh is no joke. That's why we're told to flee the very appearance of evil. That's why we're told to make no provision for the flesh. That's why we covered this Wednesday night. That's why Jesus said, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. If your hand offends you, cut it off. These are extreme measurements of separating ourselves from whatever would tempt us. Extreme. And to the carnal-minded person, such extreme maneuvers are frowned upon. Well, you're a zealot. You're an extremist. But the reason the scriptures teach us is because the wisdom of God knows our flesh. The Bible makes a statement in Job that is so true. The Bible says, the Lord putteth no trust in his saints. In his saints. In those who have called on him. Those who believe in him. Those who are trying to live according to his word. He still don't trust you. Why? Because your flesh is weak. The carnal mind will always be death. I can live 10 years of my life walking completely with the spirit mind, just whatever the spirit speaks to my conscience and my intuition. I obey that every step of the day or every step of the way. Then I wake up 10 years and one day, and I'm going to make a carnal decision today. And from one carnal decision, I begin a spiral. And it won't take me long at all. And I'll be in the depths of carnality before I even realized what has happened. I will be in death and destruction. As far as my life, my relationships are concerned, the carnal mind is death. It's the enemy of God. So nobody is above this principle. Does that make sense? It's not what our flesh wants to hear. Our flesh wants to associate with who we like. We want to associate, we're drawn to people of particular personalities, particular gifts. We're drawn to people of like mind. Their flesh likes a lot of the same things our flesh likes. So we're drawn to them. And we feel a connection with them. But I can guarantee you that connection is not from God. That connection is the enemy who is using a person so given to their carnal mind and their flesh that he knows you will be vexed, worn down over time just by association. You remember Daniel 7 and 25, and we don't have to go there for the sake of time. Elder Franco covered this verse a few weeks ago. That the plot of the enemy in the last days, as revealed from God to Daniel, Daniel prophesied that the ploy of Satan in the last days would be what? Anybody know? Wear out the saints. Not attack the saints. Not cut the saints' throat. Not pounce on you when you're least expecting it and overcome you in a moment. His plan is to day by day, by day, by day, by day, wear you down till you get to the place where the saints are so vexed in their souls by the trials and the afflictions and the persecutions and the temptations that they face, that they get so weary in righteousness. That's why Paul said, do not be weary in well-doing. But that's the ploy of the enemy. That's his plan, to get you weary in doing the right thing. So he'll bring people into your life whom you feel a connection with. And his whole ploy in bringing that connection is to wear you down. He is subtle. Even Genesis describes him as more subtle than any beast of the field. Sneaky. Crafty. And God has revealed to us, we are not ignorant of Satan's devices. We shouldn't be ignorant of Satan's devices. We all quote that verse like, I am not ignorant of Satan's devices. But you're walking right into his trap. The way you're living your life, who you're associating with, you're walking right into his trap. Quoting the verse the whole time. Getting in such close proximity to unrighteousness, not knowing that every moment that you are associated with said person, the enemy is using that to slowly wear you down. To where your soul no longer has the strength, the willpower, or the desire to do the right thing. Deep stuff, right? But it is true. It is absolutely true. For any of us who will be honest, that's exactly how the devil works against us. He is so crafty and deceptive in that very way. It is his plan to wear out the saints. However, notice what the plan of Christ is. Christ told us out of his own mouth, the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. How does he steal, kill, and destroy? He vexes us and wears us down over the course of time till we become so weak in our soul that we no longer have the strength to make the right decision to live for God. We just give in to the pressure. We give in to the stress. Right? So the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But what did Christ come to do? To give life. And that more abundant. What's Christ saying in that statement? He's saying that the enemy has a plan to, over the course of time, wear you out. And when he wears you out, he will steal everything you've ever gained. He'll kill everything you've ever tried to keep alive. And he'll destroy whatever you've worked for and build up in your life. But he does it through vexation over the course of time. But then Christ responds to the plan of the enemy by saying, "But I have come that you might have life." And then he doesn't just say that you might have life. He says, "I want to give you abundant life, a better way of living life." Like, just living is not enough. Just living life how we think we should live life is what got us into the devil's stealing, killing, and destroying traps. If we're going to escape from his stealing, killing, and destroy through slow vexation over time, the way we're going to escape that is not living the same way we've been living. We've got to live through a better lifestyle, a more abundant way of living. Make a point right here, because I want to put us all on the same page. Every one of us in this building, myself included, is in the same boat. How many of you have set out in your life and you said, you made decisions, maybe you got associated in some things or with some people that you made bad choices and they vexed you and you got to the place where you couldn't make right decisions anymore and you ended up in the same mess they were in, right? We've all been there, correct? In some way, shape, form, or fashion. Now notice this. Then we decide, you know what? I'm not going there anymore. I'm going to live for God. I'm going to live for Christ. So we lived. But we lived with the same mind and the same way of thinking that we lived before we made the choice to try and follow Christ. So if I live now with the same way of thinking that I lived when he was stealing, killing, and destroying my life, what's going to happen to me? Inevitably. It's not a matter of if. It's only when. If I live the same way with the same mentality of living life, I'm going to end up in the same place. Willpower is not enough. You have to think differently. You have to live life with a completely different mindset than what you were living previously. Because if you live the same way, if you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always gotten. Same result. Not a matter of if you're going to fall, only. So if I'm going to live life, a more abundant life, I've got to live with a more abundant or higher, a different way of thinking. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. If I think the same way, I'll be the same way. If I think differently, I'll be different. That is what Christ offered us. The enemy offers us death and destruction because of long-term vexation. Christ offers us abundant life through long-term thinking a different way. Watch this. I'm going to show you some scriptures. Matthew, very familiar scriptures, but I hope they take on a deeper meaning for us this morning. Matthew 11 and 28. This is Christ. Remember, he's revealed the plan of the enemy, vexation to steal, kill, and destroy. Come to me, Christ says. Come to me, all who are vexed. All who are so pressured by temptation and strife and struggle. All of you who are so weary that you can't even make the right choices anymore. You're so vexed that your soul is in a dead state. Willpower isn't enough. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will do what? I'll give you rest. That's the enemy doesn't ever let up. His purpose is to constantly vex you. I myself in the past couple of months have been through situations where it was one thing right after the other. Like just as soon as I thought I got one problem fixed, here came another and another and another and another and another and another and another. One right behind the other. Why? Because the enemy works to apply constant pressure. Just when you think you got one thing worked out. How many of you have felt that? Constant vexation. But Christ says, if you'll come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden. Somebody say, that's me. I get weary in my soul. But Christ says, whereas the enemy will never let you rest, he will constantly vex and torment you. It'll never let up. But Christ says, I can give you a place where you rest. That's what he offers. Notice, but it's more, I think a lot of people read this and they're like, oh, well, if I believe in Christ, then that's that rest. How many of you have believed in Christ for years now? Did your belief in Christ alone give you rest? You are more tormented now that you believe in Christ than you were before you believed in Christ. Believing in Christ is not the abundant life that Christ was talking about. Believing in Christ just allows you to walk through the door. To now you walk into a treasure trove of tools and gifts and anointings and understandings and mentalities that God will teach you wisdom and knowledge. But belief in Christ just gets you to walk through the door. What good does it do for me to walk into a treasure house and just stand at the door and say, oh, that is nice. That is great. That is so valuable. That is so precious. And I never walk over to it. I never handle it. I never cash it in. I never make use of it. So we have so many Christians that have believed in Christ that gives them access to the treasure room. That gives them access to rest. But they're standing so close to the door, the devil is reaching right through the doorway, still got a hand on their mind. Just as firm a grip as he had when they were living in sin. And this is evident because people are still living in sin after they believe in Christ. Can't quit sinning. Can't quit fornicating. Believing in Christ will not give you rest. Watch this. Watch these next couple of verses I'm getting ready to give you. Notice what Christ truly said. Now, take my yoke. You know what a yoke is, right? It's what they put on animals to link animals together when they're going to plow fields. Nobody in here has ever farmed. Maybe some of the older folks have farmed, but you probably didn't use oxen. A tractor, a hoe, something, I don't know. But anyway, that's what a yoke is. It literally binds something to something else. That's what a yoke does. Now, he just promised us rest. I will give you rest. But then he tells me, this is how rest is going to come. I'm going to put another burden on you. A yoke. I don't know how much y'all know about animals, but most animals don't enjoy having a yoke put around their neck or a bit put in their mouth. That's bondage. It feels like bondage. You're still not doing what you want to do. See, that's where the carnal mind is so vastly different from the spiritual mind. The carnal mind tells me that rest and freedom is doing what I want to do. But the spiritual mind tells me that freedom and rest is doing what Christ wants me to do. That's why people call Christianity bondage. Man, Man, I could get on a whole other lesson. Take my yoke upon you. What is Christ inviting us to then? He's inviting us. He has a yoke upon him. What is the yoke upon Christ? Obedience to God. Not my will, but your will be done. So he has put himself under bondage to do the work and the will of God. Now he's inviting me. You come in here and you get on the other side of this yoke. And let's be bound together. You bind yourself to me. I'm bound to God. You bind to me. And we will work and labor together. Freedom is not doing your own thing. Spiritual freedom is not doing your own thing. Spiritual freedom is doing what Christ commanded you. How many times did Christ say, if ye love me, keep my commandments? Everybody loves them some Jesus. But don't nobody want to obey what Jesus said? They want to love Jesus, but do their own thing. If I truly love Jesus, I'll take his yoke upon me. I'll live according to his commandments. I'll live according to his teachings. So he's promised us rest. But then he says, this is how you're going to get your rest. You don't have to be under a little bondage. You don't have to have some discipline to your life. You don't have to do what I tell you to do. Nothing else, nothing more, nothing less. It's amazing the vibe you get when you start talking about the true liberty of Christ. Because the true liberty that Christ offers is not what people think it is. It's not what they want it to be. Take my yoke upon you. And do what? In plowing, they would team up a young oxen with an old oxen who had done it for years. And by putting the young oxen with the old ox would teach, the young ox could learn from the old ox good mannerisms of plowing and work. That's why they yoked them together, so that one could teach as an example for the other. That's what Christ invited us to. Come get yoked up with me, Christ said, and let me teach you how to work for God. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me. For I am gentle. This is going to be significant when we get into the next few verses. When I ultimately get to what I'm trying to get to. For I am gentle and humble in heart. That's the example that you're going to get from Christ. When you yoke up with Christ, that's what he's going to teach you. He'll teach you to be gentle. He'll teach you to be humble. Not my will, but his be done. For I'm gentle and humble in heart. Everybody say, I'm gentle and humble in heart. Now tell your neighbor, we're going to get to that in a few minutes. Okay, now watch this. I'll give you rest, Jesus said. Then the next words out of his mouth is, but it's not the kind of rest you're thinking. You're not going to be able to do whatever you want to do. You're going to have to take my yoke. You got to get yoked up with me. I'll be your example. I'll teach you what's acceptable and what's not acceptable. I'll teach you how to live this life. But you got to take my yoke upon you. You got to learn from me. This is who I am. I am gentle and humble in heart. Inwardly, I am gentle and I am humble. We get to that in a moment. Now, then he says again, and you will find for your Think about that. He tells us we're going to find rest, but then he tells us the only way we're going to find rest is to go to work. In the carnal mind, we think rest is, well, I can do what I want. I can do what feels good. I can go with the flow. But he's telling us to find rest. If I go with the flow, let me ask you this. Let's make this real, okay? Let's come down your driveway for a little bit. How many of you have ever gotten a place in life and you were like, you just did what you wanted to do? You did what felt good? You did whatever struck you at the moment? Whatever felt good to the flesh, you did it. How did that end up? You ended up in a relationship with somebody you never should have been in. You ended up addicted to things you never should have been addicted to. You ended up doing things that you now wish I would have never done that. You're still paying for things you did 20 years ago. So how did that end up for you? You just went with the flow. You were resting. I'm doing my own thing. And the only place you ended up was in a pit of despair, with the enemy dangling people and things all around your life for the sole purpose of vexing your soul, to get you so weak and limited that you can't make the right decisions. So how did living according to your flesh end up for you? And this is ironic, right? The devil's the one offering you freedom. You do whatever you want to do. You live according to your flesh. Nobody's going to tell you right from wrong. You do whatever feels good. Freedom. Christ comes telling you the opposite. You can't be my disciple unless you take up your own cross and kill yourself. When you're ready to give up your life and live like I've lived, follow in my steps, when you're ready to do that, you can be my disciple. But in all of that work and discipline, he says that is the key to rest. I hope this sinks in. Because what the enemy is offering you as freedom is actually bondage. And what Jesus is offering you as bondage is actually freedom. Because as long, I feel the Holy Ghost in this, as long as I have lived according to Christ's commandments, I've not cheated on my wife. I've not ruined my family. I've not been hooked on drugs. I've not been hooked on alcohol. I've not been locked up for stealing. Freedom. Rest. Life. Think about that. Think about how deep that is. What Satan offers as freedom is actually bondage. What Christ offers as bondage is actually the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy, but Christ came to give you life, and that a greater way of living life than you ever lived previously. A different way of thinking. A different way of acting. A different way of living than you ever dreamed was possible. Abundantly above all that you can ask or think. You can't come up with this stuff in the carnal mind. You can only come up with it if God reveals it to you. It's that abundant. Mysteries of the kingdom of God is what it's referred to many times by Jesus and the apostles. The mysteries of the kingdom of God. What mystery? Here's a mystery. How can Christ tell me he's going to put a yoke on me and then give me rest that nobody else can ask for? Mystery. Man. A couple of more verses here. Well, actually, a few more verses. We may be a while today. Just to warn you ahead of time. Watch this. John 14:26. Again, another very familiar passage of Scripture, but I hope it means something deeper today. So Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he tells them, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit. Somebody say the Spirit. Somebody say, I've got to walk in the Spirit. That is the goal of, should be the goal of every Christian. Isn't it amazing now how many Christians are telling you you don't have to be filled with the Spirit? That's amazing. But Christ, I don't even have time to get into that. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name or in my authority, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. So whatever Christ taught the apostles when they were baptized with the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost, now that they have received the Holy Spirit of the one true God living inside of them, the Holy Spirit of the one true God, the main purpose of God giving His nature to us, His Spirit to us, was to remind me of everything Christ taught. That's what he's saying here. The purpose of the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send, the Spirit is going to teach you all things. Jesus was also telling them in this passage, I can't teach you everything now. I don't have time. But when the Holy Ghost comes, he will teach you all things. And he will bring to your remembrance everything that I have taught you in the past. He'll quicken it in your remembrance when it's time and when you need it. Now watch this, 27. Having said that, when he linked them up with the Spirit, he's tying in this, peace I leave with you. We may be here all day. When everybody talks about the Holy Spirit, at least from the circles I was raised in, coming from a Pentecostal type background, when everybody talked about the Holy Spirit, it was power. Some Holy Ghost power. And by power, they're talking about, it'll make you roll in the floor. It'll make you shake. It'll make you... How? Let me ask you this. What kind of power have you received? If when you're in church, you can... But then 2 hours later, you can't keep your eyes off of pornography. What kind of power is that? Worthless. It won't from God. Because God can keep you from living in lust, pornography. Does that make sense? Notice that when Jesus said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to you, it's going to teach you. His primary, everybody's like, oh, Holy Spirit, I can cast out some demons. You need to cast out flesh. You don't need power to cast out demons. You need the Spirit to teach you how to cast out your own flesh. What good is it for you to be casting demons out of other folks and you can't cast flesh out of your own life? Notice what Jesus is promising here. He ain't promising nothing about no demons. Why? That's secondary. True power is the ability to live above the bondage of sin and reproach. Listen, if I can live above sin and reproach, there ain't a devil in hell that I come in contact with that ever stands a chance against the authority that's in me because of holiness and righteousness. But when we talk about power, we automatically run to that, oh, demons and warfare and true power is peace. True power is the ability that when the enemy comes in like a flood and you are pressed and vexed on every side, true power is the ability to step back and say, you know what? I'm not about to let that dominate how I think and what I say next. true power is able to control one's self. We think power is being able to control sickness and disease and demons. Y'all with me? Everybody wants some healings and miracles. What about some holiness? What about some temperance? That's the kind of miracle I want to see. I want to see somebody live above sin. Jesus said, an evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign. Notice, adulterous. What's Jesus saying? You're looking for power in the wrong place. You're looking for a sign, a wonder, a miracle, a healing, when you should be looking to keep yourself from adultery. To keep yourself from evil. We're seeking the wrong kind of power. Am I saying that God doesn't heal or deliver or make? No, absolutely not. God 1,000 times has that power. But why do we not see it in our generation? Because ain't nobody got real power. The ability to live above temptation. Matthew 7:21. I say it all the time. I didn't say it. Christ said it. I repeat it all the time. Many shall say unto me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out demons? Did we not heal the sick in your name? And he'll say, depart from me, you what? Iniquity. You worried about casting out demons and sickness, and you couldn't cast out enough flesh and carnal mind out of your own life to keep you from living in sin and iniquity. So all the while you casting these demons out, you yourself are not going to make it in. Because you didn't have real power. Man. Peace, that's real power. The ability to be in a stressful situation and your emotions coming in against you like a flood, and then you can step back and turn inward. I'm going to show you some of these things in scriptures in a moment. But you have the ability to step back and turn inward and not respond in a frustrated or angry way. That, my brothers and sisters, that is power. The ability to have peace in a stressful situation, that's power. That's what he's promising us. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives. There's always a counterfeit. Remember, the devil's offering freedom, but it's actually bondage. Christ is offering bondage, but it's actually freedom. The enemy always has the opposite. Whatever Christ offers, the enemy's got something to try to replace it. A generic, a counterfeit. Christ is addressing that here. My peace I give to you. Not peace like the world gives you. The peace that the world gives you is based on circumstances. Anybody can be peaceful when everything's going your way. If I had $1 million in the bank and everybody loved me and I had perfect health, I'd be the picture of perfect worldly peace. But you let me find myself in a situation like Job. God kills my family or allows my family to be killed. Takes my health from me, takes my house from me, takes all my money from me. I'm broke, busted, and disgusted. And yet have the ability to step back and have such peace to make a statement like, though he slays me, yet will I trust him. That's the peace Christ has. That's the peace Christ is offering us. But you got to think differently. You get that level of power, to get that level of peace, you've got to think different. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give unto you. Do not let your heart be, nor... How many of you have read that verse, and you probably would never spoke it out of your mouth, but you're thinking it in your mind? Is that even possible? Is it possible for me to be in a troubling situation, but not be troubled? Is it possible to be in a fearful situation and not be fearful? How many of y'all be honest and say, when I read verses like that, I'm like, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. One of those type deals. Like, I want to believe what you're saying, but that just seems way too far beyond me. Based on how I've lived in the past, when I get in a fearful situation, I'm fearful. When I get in a troubling situation, my heart is troubled. Did Christ lie? If he told us, and notice he didn't say, I will keep your heart from being troubled. I will keep you from being fearful. Notice what he says. Do not let your heart be troubled. Like, it's your responsibility to keep your heart from being troubled. And it's your responsibility to keep yourself from becoming fearful. How many of you have been in a troubling situation or a fearful situation and you've prayed, God, help me not be troubled. God, help me not to be fearful. And you're still fearful and you're still troubled. Like, let me describe that, because some of y'all say, well, God answers my prayers. When you go and you pray it, in that moment, you feel peace simply because you're in the presence of God. You can't be troubled in the presence of God. If you're truly in the presence of God, it's impossible to be troubled, fearful. He can't stand in his presence. But how soon after you left the presence of God, within a matter of minutes, here you are being troubled. Here you are being fearful again. Why is that? Because this is not something that God is going to do for us. I can pray to not be stressed 23 and a half hours a day. But guess what I'm going to be the other 30 minutes? Stressed. When we ask, we receive not because we ask amiss. We're asking God to do things for us that God is not going to do for us. In fact, He's asked us to do this ourselves. I'm trying to help. I know what I'm saying is not easy to hear because it puts the responsibility on you. Nobody wants any more responsibility. We want it to be God's fault. We want it to be the devil's fault. The devil made me do it. No, he didn't. Let's be honest. You did it because your flesh was in control. So the buck stops with me, right? That's hard to hear. I have such faith in God. I have such faith in Christ that I expect that God is going to do everything for me. That's simply not how it works. And we ought to have lived long enough to realize and be honest with ourselves. Based on past situations, I prayed to not be fearful. I felt good while I was praying, but then I'm back fearful again. How many times have we done that? Why? Is that God's fault? Or could it be that I'm missing some understanding here? Could it be that God has given me access to a treasure room full of tools, and I'm sitting here looking, ooh, that's nice, that's nice, that's nice. but I've not put my hands on it. I've not put it in use. I've not appreciated the value or actually used these tools. What if, to my knowledge, he's not, but just for the sake of example, what if my father was a billionaire? And then one day he walks up to me and he said, "Son, here's my checkbook. Here's my account numbers. Here's my passwords. You take all my billions and you use them however you want to. Spend it however you want to." And then I put the checkbook in my pocket and then I go on about my business, living in poverty from paycheck to paycheck. Can't make ends meet. When my father has given me access to everything I'll ever need to fix my problems. We are doing the same thing spiritually through stress and worry. And I'm talking about myself. God has had to show me this in myself recently. In the recent past, I became so overwhelmed emotionally and mentally that I came to the church one night and I spent some time in prayer and God began to speak some things to me that were mind-blowing to me personally. And it was, I guess, the greatest realization or revelation, however you want to describe it, that I came to is God has given me the ability to control things that I'm not controlling. When being attacked, pressured, stressed, tempted, all of these things, I put it for the sake of what we're talking about today, are all in the same category as far as I'm concerned. Whether you're tempted because of your flesh or whether you're being pressured by the enemy, vexed, when you're living righteous, either way, they both have the same effect on my emotions. And I become troubled. Whether it's an attack from the enemy or I brought it on myself because I can't control my flesh. Either way, my emotions end up controlling me, literally controlling me, to like where I feel so down and discouraged that I know what I need to do, but yet my soul has become so vexed that I don't have the strength to make the right decision. And understanding that it does not have to be that way. From the moment God started dealing with me about this during prayer, and he gave me a number of scriptures, one or two of them I'm going to share with you here in a little bit. From that moment on, and I'm not going to present it like it's not been a fight. It's been a fight. It's work. Christ, walking with Christ is work. He called it a yoke for a reason. It's work. But since God began to reveal those things to me, it's been a completely different... I can't describe the level of freedom. Like, I still... The feelings still come, but having the ability to step back and truly not let my heart be troubled or not be fearful... or not be down and not be discouraged is a rest. I I tell you that simply to tell you this, and we're going to get into the scriptures because I know that's what you want to hear. But I tell you this, that what he's saying is absolutely true. It is possible for a follower of Christ to get to a place to where when anger comes against him, he cannot be angry. When depression comes against him, and directly speaking, this is not something God does for him. That's how we've been missing it. That's why we've been frustrated in walking with God. We think this is something God's going to... When I get depressed, God's going to deliver me. Probably not. At least not in my case. Now, y'all going to sit there and look at me like you've not come to the same understanding for yourself? And because of a lack of understanding, I'm thinking this is something God wanted to do. But God is teaching me, you have to not let your heart be troubled. You have to not let your heart be fearful. We've said that before, but I don't think we fully understand what that... I didn't fully understand what it meant. I know that's what he's promised, but actually how to walk in it, that's something completely different. Knowing Christ promised you can do this is one thing. Walking in it, that's something altogether different. Watch this. Luke 21, 16, and I reference this verse. Wednesday night, I believe it was. We quote this all the time around here as well. And again, I know I'm being lengthy today, but I'm not going to rush with this. If you get bored, you get bored and you miss it. Luke 21, 16. Jesus says, but you will be betrayed, even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends. I don't know about you, but if I go through something like that, I'd be pretty much a mess emotionally. Have been through something similar to this in the last couple of years because of doctrinal issues. And I know how it affected me emotionally. Though my flesh would never want to admit it, it did affect me. Anger, depression. But you will be betrayed. Notice what Jesus says. But you will be betrayed even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. I hadn't reached that point yet. But I have honestly and sincerely, I tell you the God's honest truth, I have contemplated many times, would it not be better if I was dead? In my own mind. Many times. I'm being honest, right? You can judge me if you want to. You judge me, that's between you and God. But for those of you that are honest and you really want some deliverance, you need to know what you're facing. This is not just Satan's plan against your life. This is Satan's plan to wear out every single saint. To vex us. To such a place that we become so weary emotionally and mentally that we stop having the strength to make the right choices. Does that make sense? But you will be betrayed even by parents, by brothers, by relatives, by friends. They will put some of you to death. 17. And you will be hated by all because we walk under the authority, the name, and that's what it means, the authority of Christ. If I'm under the authority of Christ, which means I'm walking according to the commandments of Christ, those who hate Christ are going to hate me. They might not even know why they're hating me, but because I stand for the same things that Christ taught me to stand for, they hate those things. Therefore, they hate me. So Jesus is telling us these things many times over and over and over. 18. yet not a hair of your head will perish. I think this is an interesting statement because all but one of the 12 apostles, not just their hair perished, all of them perished. They died as martyrs. But yet Jesus said, not a hair of your head will perish. He's talking about way more than what we think he's talking about. He's talking about abundant life. We think he's talking about natural life. 19. By your endurance, you will gain your lives. The way that's written is like, you're not even living life yet. Like, we're worried about a hair of my head perishing in this life. And he's telling me, you ain't even got your life yet. By enduring whatever you've got to suffer in this life, you will gain the next life. This is interesting, and I don't have time to go into all the Greek. I looked up all the Greek. But the King James of this verse says, and many of you, this will be familiar, but by your patience, you will possess your soul. And it is the Greek word for soul here. By patience, you possess your soul. But yet we're thinking, but I don't want to possess my soul, right? I want God to possess my soul. I don't want the enemy to possess my soul. I want God to possess my soul. But we miss a step in between. God gave me choice. When he created Adam and Eve in the garden, he created them with a choice. And he wanted us with that choice to choose him. So when I stand before God on judgment day, and I'm judged for the way I live my life, what God wants is for me to have lived in possession of my own soul until I can relinquish it completely to him. Does God possess my soul now and that I'm filled with the Holy Ghost? Yes, in a way. Remember we talked about the kingdom of God a while back, and I'll try not to get too caught up in that. But we talked about the kingdom of God, and everybody's talking about the kingdom of God comes. But Jesus said the kingdom of God is within you. It's already here. Some of you will not taste death. He's talking to the apostles. Some of you will not taste death until you've seen the kingdom of God come with power. What's he talking about? The Holy Ghost. The union of God's Spirit with the soul of humanity. The Spirit working to save that person's soul. But the soul is not totally saved until judgment. I'm born again, and I have been given the earnest of my inheritance, which means a down payment of the inheritance that God's promised me. But I won't receive the full inheritance until after judgment. So I've got to possess my vessel in sanctity and in honor all the days of my life, walk in righteousness and holiness, being blameless and harmless, the Son of God, without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. And if I can do that, the down payment that I have received in the form of the Holy Ghost, once I stand before him and the true manifestation of the salvation, the total salvation of my soul, is that my soul at that point will be put into an immortal body. But until that point, I've got to possess my vessel in sanctity and honor so that I might receive. Why did Paul say, lest I myself, when I have preached to others, I myself become a castaway? Paul understood, I've got to possess my own soul, my mind, my will, my emotions. I've got to be in such control of it. And of course, that is because of the influence of the Holy Ghost. I can't do it with my carnal mind. I've got to be under the influence of the Holy Spirit of God, teaching me how to keep my soul from sin. So when I say I possess my soul, don't think I'm saying this is, I can do this of my own power. I need His Spirit to teach me how to possess my mind, my will, and my emotions under control to the leading of His Holy Spirit. Right? You get that? So that on Judgment Day, I can present myself blameless. That's what he's saying here. Now notice, you possess your soul. So I've got to be in possession of my own soul. So what then is the key to being able to possess, for me to be in control of my mind, my will, and my emotions, and not the enemy to be in control of my mind, my will, and my emotions? What's the key? In ASB is endurance. King James is we quote it all the time, but do we really stop to think? What is he saying? What is Jesus saying to us here? The ability for me to be in a situation, stressful situation, that inwardly I want relief from immediately. And the easy way out is to give in to the temptation. Do I get relief from vexation if I give in to the temptation? Immediately I do. The pleasures of sin, there are pleasures in sin, but they only last for a season. So let's say I get tempted, and to alleviate that pressure, that vexation, I give in to it. Immediately it feels good. It gratifies the flesh. But then now I get a day removed, and I am under such conviction and condemnation, and I'm back being vexed in a greater way than I was before. First, I'm being vexed with temptation. Now I'm being vexed with temptation and condemnation because I already gave in to it. So it compounds itself. And the burden gets heavier and heavier and heavier. And I get vexed more and more and more until I'm so weak and weary that I literally cannot. I do not have the strength in me emotionally or mentally to make the right decision. Then I am a slave to sin. But if when I am tempted and that temptation comes, and instead of wanting to get rid of the pressure, I have the ability to step back, distance myself from what I'm feeling and my temptations. If I have that ability to just be able to pause, it doesn't take long. But pause for a moment and say, you know what? My emotions don't rule me. I rule my emotions. I'm going to have to explain that in detail. I get that. If I forget, remind me. I'll be happy to address that question later. But that's what he's teaching us. And I'll show you a number of other verses that confirm this. In patience, having the ability to step back, separate myself from my emotions, my thoughts. And this is how God taught it to me. Quiet my soul. We'll get into that in a moment. The ability to quiet my soul is what I believe Jesus is referring to when he talks about patience. And this is why. Because in that moment, And let's say we're not even talking about temptation now. Let's say we're talking about persecution. And persecution is coming. I've not done anything wrong. I've lived according to the Word of God. I've lived according to the commandments of Christ. Yet the enemy is vexing me with other people betraying me or other people hating me because I'm doing the right thing. In that moment, I want to so get rid of the vexation that I have a choice. I can relieve that vexation carnally by relating to the people who are persecuting me, or by getting in their good graces, starting to think like they do, quit preaching against their unrighteousness would be the easiest way to alleviate the pressure. Just quit telling them they're doing wrong. And the vexation eases up. But instead of carnally responding to the vexation of my soul, if I have the ability to step back and see things from a completely different perspective and understand, you know what, the emotion of loneliness that is coming against me through these people, that it makes me feel ostracized, it makes me feel lonely, and I so want to alleviate the feeling, the emotion of loneliness, that I'll make vexed, weak-souled decisions, whereas I can step back, see the situation like God sees it, and I literally have the ability to possess my mind, my will, and my emotions. And then I can respond to the situation instead of reacting. That's what we do, right? When we get stressed, when we feel the pressure, we hate it so bad that we just react. But what if I could wait and not give? And somebody's making me angry. The feeling of anger is raging inside of me. The emotion of anger is pumped up. What if I could step back and have enough wisdom to say, you know what? I'm not even going to be angry about this. I'm going to control. I'm not going to allow myself. I know that sounds like an impossibility, but it is not an impossibility. I'm telling you the God's honest truth. The only reason we think it's impossible is because we've been living according to the carnal mind. God has given us access to a treasure room. Christ, when they sat him down in that judgment hall, and they blindfolded him, and they smote him, and they spit on him, and they pulled his beard with their hands, according to what Isaiah prophesied. Plucked his beard with their bare hands. How did Jesus keep from reacting in anger? He had patience. But what does patience practically look at? Because we can talk about, well, you need to have patience. You need to have patience. Well, you're angry. You need to have patience. You need to have patience. That means nothing to us. It's words. What it really means to have patience is that when they're pulling my beard out with their bare hands, I have the ability to step back. I am not going to allow that emotion of anger and revenge. It doesn't dictate me. I dictate it. God has taught me and given me the ability to be able to take authority. See, we talking about, and I've done this before in myself. I'll talk about myself. I ain't even going to mess with nobody else. Talk about myself. Anger comes against me. I'm like, I bind you, anger, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I bind you, you spirit of anger. It's not a spirit of anger. It's my emotions. There might be a spirit operating to cause to try to get me to respond in anger. But that spirit doesn't possess me. That spirit works to get me to decide what he wants me to do. He doesn't call the shots. I call the shots. He just tempts me to call the wrong shot. But if I had the ability to step back, this is what's going on right now. God has a greater plan. It could be God can reveal a number of things in an instant of a second. If we would just learn to patience. God will give you direction. He will tell you what's working against you. He'll tell you why the enemy's trying to get you to feel the way that he's trying to get you to feel. He'll tell you what's going to happen if you give in to that moment. The situation will play. Prophecy will be rolling right through your mind of how this situation is going to play out. If you don't get a grip of your own soul, how do I possess my own soul? Patience. I don't react. I step back. I assess the situation, and God gives me divine information and His divine viewpoint through the Holy Ghost. And then He will teach me how to possess my vessel in sanctification and honor. But the reason we get so overwhelmed is because we don't step back into that secret place. We just think, well, this is how life is. Just overwhelmed by emotion. This is how I've always dealt with things, is just reacting out of my flesh. And that's how we keep on. But Christ didn't come to give us just regular life. He came to give us abundant life. Regular life is you're standing here overwhelmed by emotion and you react to that emotion and it literally controls you. But abundant life is you step back. You assess. You decide, am I going to allow myself to feel this emotion or not? Am I going to allow myself to give in to this temptation or not? This is the way God showed it to me. It puts a buffer. It puts distance. In warfare, distance is everything. Why do you think as technology has progressed, used to back in the day, God, I've been so long. Back in the day when they would fight warfare, it was hand to hand. It was, you saw them eyeball to eyeball and you were on top of one another rolling around on the ground until somebody can get a hand loose to stab the other one with a knife. It was intimate. It was up close. It was personal. You smelled him. He drips sweat and blood on you while you're fighting in battle. Now, we shoot at somebody from 1,000 yards away with a sniper rifle. They never see it coming. Or, worse yet, we fly an airplane over 50,000 feet in the sky that they can't even see with the naked eye and drop a bomb on them and boom, they all gone. Blow the whole mess of them up. And as technology has progressed, so does warfare get... Why? As knowledge has increased, so has the distance in warfare, because there's a basic principle at play. In warfare, distance is everything. So why does God in His wisdom tell me flee the very appearance of evil? Separate yourselves. Because God understands distance in warfare. When we're warring for the soul of man, distance is everything. So having patience then, I'm on the front lines of the battle. The soldier on the front lines is not worried about the grand scheme of how, well, we're going to flank around this side and we're going to attack their supplies from the backside. The soldier on the front lines, all he can think about is there are bullets whizzing past my head. If I don't get behind a rock, I'm going to die. He is not worried about the grand scheme of how this war is going to play out. All he can see is the enemy. All I can focus on is the temporary, the now. But a general is standing way back from a distance. And he's looking at how the whole war is playing out. And he's making decisions more informed, cool, calm, and collected decisions. Whereas the soldier right here is so overwhelmed with emotion. But the general is back. He's not overwhelmed. His life is not in imminent danger. So the decisions he makes is the best for the big. That's warfare. When you are so associated with things and people, you can't see it for what it really is. And you are so overwhelmed with emotion. But I love this person. But they're getting ready to kill you and you don't even know it. What if we all, in fighting this spiritual warfare, had the ability to step back and get the general's perspective? Because in warfare, distance is everything. If I'm up here, all I have is a knife to stab him with. If I'm back here, I can push a button and drop a bomb on him and the deal is over with. Patience, distance. Okay. I hope I've explained that well enough. Let's get into some of these other scriptures. I want to start with Psalm 37. I want to show you some of these, the wisdom of God playing out even in the Old Testament. 37 and 1. Been talking so much, my mouth is dry. All right, watch this. We're talking about that upfront, close contact, spiritual warfare. David, I don't even know if David fully understood it because he didn't seem to have the baptism of the Holy Spirit like we have. But God was revealing some things, some principles to David that are amazing. In light of how the Spirit brings clarity now, it's amazing. Watch this. Psalm 37 and 1. Do not fret because of evildoers. People are doing you wrong. What is our reaction? But David's saying, do not fret because of evildoers. Be not envious towards... I could go into that. You say, well, I've never been envious of somebody doing wrong. How many of you have ever been done wrong by someone, and in some way, shape, form, or fashion, you don't even realize what you're doing? But because they have the upper hand and they're hurting you, you then subconsciously figure out a way to hurt them. Why do you do that? Because you're envious of the fact that they're holding the sword. Do not fret because of evil doing. Yeah, that's fine. We got to move on. For they will wither quickly like the grass and fade like the green herb. This writer is now, verse 1 is front lines mentality. Verse 2 is up on the hill general mentality. For they will wither quickly like the grass and fade like the green herb. Watch this as this plays out. Trust in the Lord and do good. Don't let your heart fret when you're attacked. We think when we're attacked, well, I got to deal with it and they've hurt me. And we don't even take the time to be patient enough to step back and look at this from a bigger perspective. We're not patient enough to take the time. We'd rather just fulfill our flesh and react. Because the flesh alleviates the pressure short term. But if I step back and refuse to allow their attacking me to cause me feelings of despair, loneliness, betrayal, I don't immediately alleviate the pressure. They're still attacking. The emotions are still coming. Does that make sense? I don't know if that's... Reaction, whether right or wrong, either way, when we react, we get instant gratification. That's why we do it. Whereas to have patience means you step back. There is no instant gratification. The feelings are still there. The fight is still going on. The battle is still raging. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land. Dwell is a permanent term, like long term. Dwell. We're not passing through the land. God wants us to dwell. Put up with it. Live here. Don't have plans to leave. This is not going to be over soon. Dwell, abide, reside, put up with it, endure. That's the language. Dwell in the land and cultivate. To cultivate a crop takes time. You don't go out and plant a seed overnight and expect an apple tree full grown with apples the next day. It takes time to cultivate anything. And God, what is the writer of the psalm alluding to here? Patience. Wait. This is so good to me. 4. Delight yourself in the Lord. Don't delight yourself in gratification of the flesh, immediate gratification of the flesh. Delight yourself in stepping back and saying, okay, how do I handle this? Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. How many times have you ever heard that verse quoted? And the Lord will give me the desires of my heart. But what you're getting is not the desires of your heart. You're getting the desires of your flesh. You're getting the lust of the flesh. That's what they're praying for God. They want the lust of the flesh given to them. I ain't got time to go into all that. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Because when you step back and you dwell in a place and you're patient in a place of waiting, you cultivate faithfulness. God will teach you what you should be desiring to begin with. So once God has taught you what you should be desiring, sure, then He can give you the desires of your heart. But when you're down here asking for the desires of your flesh, getting frustrated because they never come, two very different things. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He will do it. You've got to have the ability to let your enemy attack you all the while you step back and wait. And in your waiting, you are cultivating. You're building. You're increasing. You're growing. Six. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your judgment as the noonday. What that means to me is, if I will step back and wait on God in His timing, He'll show me the right thing to do. He will show me the right way to respond. He will show me how to judge the situation, and I'll see it just like it's noonday, under the noonday sun. But when I'm down here fighting and wrestling with the emotions and don't take the time to step back, righteousness is not coming, and judgment is going to be as clear as mud. And we will waver. One day we'll judge it this way. Next day we'll judge it this way. And we're back and forth, back and forth. Oh, I wish I had time to get in all those verses. Double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Ephesians 4 teaches us that we so learn of Christ that we're not tossed to and fro anymore. He will bring forth your righteousness. Rest. When I'm down here and I'm overwhelmed with the emotions, it's constant vexation. But when I have the ability to step back and say, you know what? My emotions are not going to dominate me. I'm going to sit right here until God shows me if it's okay to feel this way or not. And God will give me judgment like the noonday sun. But right here is a place of rest. The moment you can step back, even when you don't know what to do yet, even when you don't know how to respond to what's going on yet, when you step back, it immediately puts you in a place of rest. It gives you reprieve from the attack of these emotions and thoughts and temptations and persecutions. You know what? I wish I could describe it better. I just hope it gets through. That's all I can hope. Rest in the Lord. That's that stepping back. That's that possession. Or that's that patience, that waiting. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Then he goes into the same stuff Jesus said. Do not fret because of Him. This is not, God's going to, not, it's not that God's going to keep you from fretting. It's that God instructs you not to let yourself fret. How do I not let myself fret? Step back. I feel like fretting. I'm not going to fret. Unless God tells me to worry about it, I'm not going to worry about it. That's how I do not let myself fret because of Him who prospers in His way. Because of the man who carries out wicked schemes. Cease from anger. When y'all read that, Do you get the impression that God's saying, I'm going to keep you from ever getting angry? Or do you get the impression that God's saying, you are going to have to stop yourself from being angry? What impression do you come away with? Is that a commandment? Is that something I have to do? It absolutely is, without question. I have to cease from anger. I have to forsake wrath. How do I do that? But I'm so overwhelmed. You don't know what they're saying is making me so angry. What they're doing is making me so angry. To respond with patience means I step back. I possess my soul. I'm not a slave to emotion. I possess my soul. And I sit and I wait. God, is it okay to be angry about this? Most of the time, he's going to tell you no. There are some situations where it's okay to be angry. Maybe we'll get into that in future lessons. Cease from anger. Forsake wrath. Do not fret. Don't worry. Don't be anxious. If you are worrying, you've not stepped back. I'm going to stop right here when we get to 37 and 11. But use this as a litmus test to figure out if you truly are in possession of your own soul, or if your emotions are in possession of your soul, or the enemy is in possession of a more clear way, or more perfect way of saying it is the enemy is in control of your soul through your emotions. Cease from anger, forsake wrath, do not fret. So if I'm angry, and God hasn't told me to be angry, or if I'm speaking and acting in wrath, but God has not told me to speak and act in wrath, or if I'm worried, fretting, and God has not told me to worry. And I don't know of a case where God would ever tell you to worry, to be honest. So if I'm feeling these things, that means I'm still on the forefront of this battle, right in the heat of the battle, still in my emotions. I'm not in control of my soul. The enemy is in control of my soul through my emotions. So if I'm feeling these things, I know where I'm at. If I'm feeling these things and God's not given me the ability to feel those things or told me to feel those things, I got to step back. I got to get to a place where I decide in my mind, you know what, I'm not going to worry about this. I'm going to wait on God. I'm not going to get angry about this. I'm going to wait on God. I'm not going to act in wrath. I'm going to wait on God. Makes sense? Verse 9. For evildoers will be cut off. Here again, he's speaking to the long term. He's saying, you're getting all up in arms because these people are doing you wrong. Whereas, step back here a little bit and let me show you the broad picture. Let me show you what's eventually going to happen in this situation. Eventually, these people who are doing you wrong, I'm going to cut them off. But those who wait for the Lord, they will inherit the land. But if I don't wait on the Lord and I get caught up in my emotions, I'm going to give in to selfish gratification. The enemy's going to destroy me because I walked in the carnal mind. He's going to inherit the land. But if I step back, I wait on the Lord. The Lord teaches me how to going to play out and how I need to respond. Eventually, God will destroy my enemy and God will let me be the king over this territory. But what's the key? What's the difference? Patience. Waiting. Stepping back and seeing what God has to say. How will God teach me to handle the situation? Yet in a little while and the wicked man will be no more. And you will look carefully for his place, and he will not be there. That's the general's perspective. But the humble, and I'm not even going to try to get into this. Remember Jesus said, for I am meek and humble in heart? At some point, as God gives us opportunity, I'm going to teach on that. But the humble will inherit the land and will delight themselves in abundant prosperity. that treasure room. You've been sitting for a long time. Stand with me while we pray today, if you would, please. Just physically stand. Lift your hands. And just pray as the Spirit leads you right here, first and foremost. But pray that we gain understanding of this. Father, I want to understand this. I want to apply this. I want to walk practically in this every day of my life. I want this abundant life that's being presented to us through the Scriptures this morning. I'm tired of living and thinking the same way I've been thinking, just giving myself over to fret and worry and anger and depression and discouragement. Teach me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me all things, as Jesus said. Teach me these mysteries of your kingdom, God. Teach me how to walk, yielding and the treasures that you've made available to me. To walk in abundant prosperity. Teach me patience. Teach me to wait on you, O God. For they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll find a state of rest and strength and revival and renewal. Help me, Father. We need to keep praying this the next few days, okay? Keep praying. God, give me understanding. God, give me clarity. And apply these things. When you leave this place today, you can practice this. You can practice this from this moment forward for the rest of your life. You're not waiting on anything. You don't need any more understanding. You've got enough this morning to get started in the right direction. To practice stepping back, waiting, controlling, possessing your own soul as God teaches you how to do that. Not just reacting out of flesh and emotion and feelings. You do realize Solomon said the heart above all things is deceitful and desperately wicked. Your emotions will deceive you. So you got to be in control of them and them not in control of you. Elders, y'all have something else you want to add? All right. You can be seated. Any questions?
Tremendous. There was an abundance of meat in what was spoken today. And I thank God not just for what was spoken, but for what was spoken, what it can do for us if we apply it, if we receive it. I want to encourage everyone to let's go back and listen to everything that was spoken today. We understand that the flesh is only capable of so much, and it probably wasn't able to obtain everything that was spoken, unless you're just incredibly smart. Even if you are, you need to go back and do it anyways, because we're not trying to receive this through our flesh. Amen. We need to receive this through the Spirit. There were many things, powerful principles that were spoken. I want to encourage us at some point throughout the week, whether it be iTunes, YouTube, getting up with Brother Tim, asking for an old-fashioned CD. Yes, old-fashioned CD. They are old-fashioned these days because I don't use them. But I would use one in this case. Amen? But I thank God for iTunes because I don't have to. Nevertheless, I want to encourage us to go back and do that. Would you do that, those of us that know God was dealing with you with numerous things? Would you please make that a point to do this week? Amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his countenance to shine upon you. The grace of our Lord Jesus be with your spirit. You're dismissed today in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in the love of God.